March is celebrated in some parts of the world as Women's History Month, जो बहुत बढ़िया चीज है सेलिब्रेट करने के लिए। और इसी सेलिब्रेशन का हिस्सा बनते हुए पेश है कई हफ्तों की प्रोक्रेस्टिनेशन के बावजूद मस्ट वॉच डॉक्यूमेंट्रीज अबाउट वुमेन पार्ट वन। यस, देयर आर टू पार्ट्स, मेनी डॉक्यूमेंट्रीज। Starting with number 10 in no particular order, Pretend It's a City on Netflix. I'd be lying if I said I knew a bunch about Fran Lebowitz before this show and had read her books. But the honest truth is this show has now contributed in a big way towards helping to shape my evolving approach towards people, careers, places we live, money, and identity as a woman. Maybe I should be ashamed to admit that I only went into this 7-part docu-series because it was easily accessible and on Netflix and it was presented by Martin Scorsese. But almost instantly, I was taken by Fran and I realized how much I was waiting to meet someone like her. The woman dresses like a Gen Z, by the way, center part, hair and everything, without even realizing how cool that makes her. The show is a collage of a series of conversations conducted by Scorsese with his longtime friend, author, essayist, social commentator, ex-film critic Fran Lebowitz. And through 95% of these conversations, Scorsese is only seen nudging her to speak, never taking center stage himself, editing his questions and whole presence in a way that doesn't overshadow Fran Lebowitz at any point. Through these conversations and other recordings, the show talks about Fran's relationship with New York City, providing an insight into why New York is celebrated so much as the heart of everything that's good, and yet not ignoring the other stuff like insanely high real estate prices, rude taxi drivers, and general pretentiousness some New Yorkers tend to possess. All of that aside, I mostly devoured this series because Fran makes me want to be more me. Hearing her speak is a gift and honor. None of us should be allowed to talk in public or on camera unless we can first learn how to write and converse like her. I have not related to a whole lot of women on screen as much as I did with the 70-year-old Fran. When she talks about recognizing a lack of talent in herself, when she talks of simmering irritation and says, "The anger is that I have no power, but I'm filled with opinions." Or even a throwaway observation like, "It's impossible to be a satirist in this generation." She makes me want to work towards finding a newer, more challenging and satisfying way to channel my disillusionment with the world we live in through my writing. And also, it's a reminder to not give away laughter easily, if that makes sense. Reserve approval, and when you do laugh, laugh with meaning. It's an incredible series, y'all. Watch if you haven't yet. And tell me if you find the older Scorsese docu about Fran Lebowitz called Public Speaking anywhere, because legally to mujhe kahin nahi mila. Number 9. The New York Times presents Framing Britney Spears. You can watch it on Hulu. There is a reason why this documentary was the only thing anyone could talk about for a few weeks after it released last month, Justin Timberlake apology notwithstanding. I have a full review up on my channel. If you see this link right above me here somewhere, jaake dekho, okay? Number 8, For Summer, watch it for free on pbs.org. I watched this Oscar-nominated BAFTA-winning film at the MAMI Film Festival in 2019, sitting in the front row of the theater because that's how many people flocked to the screening. This documentary, shot for the most part on a handheld camera, tells the story of a young couple in Aleppo, Syria. Hamza is a doctor and his wife is the director of this docu, Waad, and they have a young toddler, Sama. Short vlog style, Waad takes us through the 5 years before Aleppo fell in the ongoing Syrian civil war and what it took for her and her husband to continue resisting the blitzkrieg of hostile attacks while supporting their community. The Syrian conflict is brutal. Its truth is unforgiving, and Waad Al-Kataib's movie doesn't want to be an easy watch either. There's dead children, gory accidents, buildings destroyed, rampant poverty and destruction in sharp focus, without the movie ever trying too hard. And Waad is not ashamed or afraid to show you the bleakest of truths in her international Emmy-winning journalistic work, that's this film. When she loses her daughter for a few minutes amid smoke from an airstrike, she keeps filming, looking for her. When her husband and his team of doctors and nurses nearly die from having to constantly change hospital locations, she keeps recording. When bombs land dangerously close to her neighbor's home, where parents are trying to keep their kids occupied, she keeps ruling. Alag hi level ka patriotism, na jaane kaisi humanity these two have. Waad and Hamza, they visit Turkey for a brief bit and you're almost relieved that they are safe. But they come right back to serve their community. Hamza as a much needed doctor and Waad as someone who felt it her responsibility to document and share with the world the siege of Aleppo. In the middle of Hamza's work as a surgeon in makeshift operation rooms, he also does regular appearances on international news channels, asking the world to pay attention. Waad wants you to see this is war. Bombs fall from the sky as people cook their meals. There are no superheroes holding upturned buses aloft with their super strength as civilians crowd under it, overwhelmed by Hans Zimmer's rousing background music. This is real. It's borderline mundane for people trying to survive it. Through her intimate voiceover, Waad dedicates this movie to her then one-year-old daughter, Sama, explaining to her why she continues to hope and bring more lives into a broken world. By extension, talking to a future generation that might be able to help Syria, perhaps better equipped. Alright, before moving on to today's top two, just a small reminder, no big deal, do please subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Click that little square in the corner, it should be here somewhere. Number 7, RBG on Hulu. Another Oscar-nominated documentary, RBG, is the incredible story of Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, released in 2018, 2 years before her death. And if nothing else, you must watch it to just stay updated with global politics right now, get a glimpse into what she stood for and why she refused to retire till the day she died. As far as structuring goes, RBG is simple and straightforward, much like the Britney Spears documentary. I suspect it's because the film realizes it's trying to document a lot within a limited time frame, and unnecessary frills and zigzags might make it more convoluted than it needs to be. So, much like Justice Ginsburg herself, the film is a no-nonsense look into her professional life from when she first started law school till 2018, refusing to retire. Opening with recordings from men in official positions going on the record calling her a witch, a disgrace, a monster, disrespectful, vile, anti-American, it cuts straight to the octogenarian holding planks at the gym while her neck can barely hold the weight of her own head. The makers, Betsy West and Julie Cohen, are quite clear that they are straight up aiming to provide you a crash course in the legacy of RBG. Not an easy task considering how much RBG's decades of work continues to affect lives till date, not just in America but world over. The movie goes out of its way to acknowledge how much of a supportive partner RBG had in her husband back in the 50s when her female classmates at Cornell had to suppress how smart they were in order to not intimidate the men around them. Forget the 50s, I used to have that thought in my 20s. Ki, why am I single? Should I pretend to be silly and simple to attract a man? Can you imagine? You find out RBG went to Harvard after she had had her first child. But frankly, my strongest takeaway from the film is the fact that all the RBG merchandise, buttons, t-shirts, books, etc., we see almost all of it features her face well into her old age, despite her being an extremely towering, well-known figure throughout her career. Why? Because when the internet became easily available to the regular public, more women found global platforms to celebrate other women they liked without the barrier of men calling the shots. More women gradually had the means to spread the message of RBG to a younger generation, to people outside the United States, by which time Ruth Bader Ginsburg looked like the woman we see on all these t-shirts. And that to me is incredible. The fact that she first got the moniker Notorious RBG in 2013 after Shana Kisnick started a Tumblr meme page, which turned into a book in 2015. Despite the fact that Justice Ginsburg had been doing incredible work bringing about change for women's rights since the 70s, it was only 7 years ago that a whole new generation of women decided to start celebrating her in a big way. Gloria Steinem appears in the documentary and says, "Ruth's work made me feel like I was protected by the US Constitution for the first time." Just like her work, the movie is reassuring, a giant ray of sunshine for a day you're feeling zara defeated. Number 6, Honeyland, also on Hulu. Nominated for Best Documentary at the Oscars the same year for Sama, in fact the first documentary also nominated under Best International Feature Film, Honeyland takes you to the Republic of North Macedonia, into the life of beekeeper Hatice Muratova, a single woman who lives in an abandoned village with her bedridden old mother, and she farms wild honey in the most natural ways, which she then sells in the country's capital, copie, earning a meager living. Honeyland is one of the most profound movie watching experiences I've ever had, y'all. With constant intrigue, this incredible, quite deep and melancholic documentary unfolds like a drama thriller with a screenplay, plot points, hero versus villain, external evil force, betrayal, all is lost, a death, everything. And yet it's slow and steady, mobile and immovable, a part of the hilly Macedonian landscape. And look, it's turned me into a terrible fucking poet. I don't even know what I just said above, but Honeyland really is poetry in motion, if I may. Made on grant money from the San Francisco International Film Festival and North Macedonian Film Agency, this film was shot over 3 arduous years. You meet Hadize as she climbs perilously the side of a mountain where she knows wild bees have a colony. Respectfully taking only a little at a time, she returns and adds either bees or the honeycomb itself to a literal hole in the wall next to her house where she cultivates her own bee colony. She lives in a house with no electricity or water, and you're made to feel that that's what you're going to be now watching, a story of a traditional vocation and how these kinds of professions are dying out, until boom, Hadize starts talking to her mother about her father and family and why she never got married. The film is thick and viscous like honey. Hadize almost constantly is seen wearing a dull yellow honey-colored sweater. It's a nature documentary and also a commentary on greedy capitalism. It's about the mother-daughter relationship, but also men versus women. It's defeatist, but also fiercely feminist. The protagonist lives amongst vast valleys and huge mountains, but is trapped within a dark room with her mother. Her songs to the bees are soothing, but her predicament gets more frustrating as you go. In one scene, Hadize watches the nomadic neighbors make a dish antenna out of a metal plate by poking holes through it to catch better radio signal. While you're watching the movie stream through super fast, unlimited Wi-Fi in your homes, you're acutely aware of the lives of many, many privileges afforded to you. And frankly, now that we've seen a global pandemic unfold, unfairly impacting people across the world, socioeconomic lines, that survivor's guilt might be stronger than usual when you're watching. In the 3 years the filmmakers spent in this Macedonian village documenting Hadize's life, they managed to capture some truly incredible shots. A child almost drowning, bees fighting each other, many, many sunsets, Hadize's chasing some dogs, a tree on fire. And when it's all compressed together in under 90 minutes, it makes for an excellent, engaging, urgent cinematic experience. And I think aaj ke liye itna kaafi hai. So to round up in this part one list of 10 docs about women I recommend you watch, we spoke about Pretend It's a City, Framing Britney Spears, For Sama, RBG and Honeyland. Tell me about your favorites in the comments, huh? Please. Part two out in a few days, right here on the channel, with an emphasis on Indian women and apni kahaniya. So do please make sure you subscribe to the channel, you click on that bell so a notification will pop up, check the merch shelf under this video, and happy Women's History Month, everybody.